This program was made possible in part by the Roy H. Park School of Communications at Ithaca College and by Roger Rada.
On a city bus, if there were seats available in the front of the bus and none available in the back of the bus, I still could not sit down. That was separate, but it wasn't equal.
I came in as a day porter, then I was allowed to sell shoes. But I could not sell shoes to white ladies. I could not touch a white lady's foot.
You look down there, and the water pipe, and one pipe that came up. Then when it got up there, then it divided this way, and one went white and one went black.
Your parents can tell you you're equal to everybody else, but at the same time, the society and everything around you is telling you something different.
She asked me, who was I and what was I? And then I said, I'm an American. And she said, no, you're not. You're colored.
We, the disinherited of this land, we who have been oppressed so long, are tired of going through the long night of captivity. Now we are reaching out for the daybreak of freedom and justice and equality.
On May 17, 1954, the Supreme Court ruled in Brown versus Board of Ed that the practice of separate but equal had no place in public education. The decision was a turning point in the battle to end segregation. But Jim Crow would not go quickly or quietly. Those who had benefited from America's constitutional contradiction fought to maintain their privilege and power. Making equality a reality would require a movement that would render unto no one evil for evil, but instead would meet the forces of hate with the power of love. There are no exact numbers as to how many people participated in the civil rights movement. Many stood up, stepped up, and spoke up, but there's one name that stands out. This story starts in Montgomery.
Montgomery was the location of the Dexter Avenue Baptist Church. It was a very important church in Montgomery, the capital city of Alabama. And it had a custom of bringing in well-educated, articulate, charismatic ministers.
And Dexter Avenue Baptist Church at the time, one of the most elitist churches in Montgomery. You had the college professors and all of the teachers, doctors and dentists going to Dexter Church.
Now, I had heard of Dexter, of course, in the sense that that Vernon Johns was the pastor here, and he was known as a fire and brimstone preacher.
Johns was he's charismatic and intellectual of the first rate, but he also was controversial, outspoken, and confrontational.
He did not mind crunching a few toes in what he said, because he said on more than one occasion, you aren't doing enough. You need to do more.
There are a number of episodes between Vernon Johns and the congregation led to the final dismissal of Johns, or the acceptance of his resignation. And so there was a look of search for a new minister. Robert Nesbitt, who was a deacon at the Dexter Avenue Baptist Church at the time, understood that there was a charismatic, young, articulate minister by the name of Martin Luther King, who lived in Atlanta. And so Nesbitt travels to Atlanta to entice King to come to Montgomery and to do a trial sermon to be considered for the pastorate at Dexter Avenue Church.
So he came in the shop. I asked him, what was his name, like you do most new customers? He said, Martin Luther King. I said, where are you from? He said, Atlanta, Georgia. I said, what are you doing in town? He said, I'm here to preach my trial sermon at Dexter. I said, oh, that's my church.
He came and gave his trial sermon. And I'll never forget, it was entitled 3D in Religion. The way he developed that theme was so catching and so well done, of course, that we just said, there's no use in pursuing this pastorate any further. He is the man.
When the Dexter Avenue Baptist Church looked for a new pastor, they were looking for someone who was going to be adroit, an academic, astute, a good oratorical skills, but they wanted someone who was not going to be as controversial, not going to be as confrontational. And they thought they had that person in Martin Luther King.
One of the things that Martin emphasized, that every member of the church needed to be a registered voter. That caused a few people to, especially some of the older women, to say, well, now, Vernon Johns was here with his verboseness, shall I say, and now look here we go again.
If you look at Montgomery in the mid-1950s, we have the perfect storm that sort of happens in Montgomery. I say storm, but I mean that in a good way.
There is a confluence or a number of people and events that occur and come together at the same time that's a bit uncanny. Joanne Robinson, who's been in Montgomery as a professor of English at Alabama State, and she joins the Women's Political Council, and she becomes president of the Women's Political Council.
Attorney Fred Gray getting his law license and setting up a practice here in Montgomery.
He pushes the Montgomery Improvement Association to not only boycott the buses, but also to litigate and to sue the bus system in the wake of the Brown versus Board of Education case.
Judge Frank M. Johnson is appointed to the Middle District of the federal courts here in Montgomery.
Professor James Pierce, he is going to talk to his students about the gulf between the pronouncements of liberty, justice, and equality in the founding documents of this nation and the reality that they saw when in majority black belt counties, they could not vote.
And the movement really doesn't take steam until Rosa Parks is arrested on December 1st, 1955. So there's some months between the time that the Kings arrive and the Montgomery bus boycott gets started.
I think as a result of a number of people being here, a number of events occurring nationally with the Brown versus Board of Education case, and the ground being cultivated over decades by a number of indigenous Montgomeryans, and, you know, created an opportunity in the mid-1950s for King to step in and sort of reap the benefits of that through the creation of the Montgomery Improvement Association.
And there were two black men in Montgomery that did not get along with each other. One of them had an idea that the best way for black people to get the right to vote. The other man said the best way to do it is go to court.
Rufus Lewis is seen as a leader in his own right. He's seen as a leader of the black middle class in Montgomery. He's a business owner. He works at Alabama State. He had been a successful football coach, librarian. And so he was looked up to by the black educated in Montgomery. Edie Nixon, on the other hand, lived in West Montgomery. He was seen as a labor leader. He had little formal education. He was a powerful man, strong baritone voice. He was an advocate for black people. He negotiated on behalf of black people with the city authorities. He was seen as a champion of the common man, the working man in Montgomery. And so there was also a sentiment that you may lose the support of the common man if you pick somebody like Rufus Lewis. On the other hand, you may lose the support of the black middle class if you pick somebody like E.D. Nixon.
Mr. Nixon was the president of the NAACP, and Mrs. Rosa Parks was Mr. Nixon's secretary. So the NAACP was the only formal organization blacks had at that time. So if it's going to be a legitimate vote, Mr. Nixon automatically become the president of the new organization. But Mr. Lewis did not want that. He figured this young man, by most people didn't know too much about him at that time, would be better.
So in some sense, Martin Luther King, who was brand new to Montgomery, the thought was he would not alienate any segment of black Montgomery, and so that the total black population may be able to coalesce around Martin Luther King's leadership.
When he spoke in that church that night and he said, if we are wrong, the Constitution of the United States is wrong.
And we are not wrong. We are not wrong in what we are doing. If we are wrong, the Supreme Court of this nation is wrong. If we are wrong, the Constitution of the United States is wrong. If we are wrong, God Almighty is wrong.
That's what really kind of got people to understand that this was a movement that was about to take shape. And it was in that moment in that church at Whole Street Baptist Church when really I think the movement really kind of not only coalesced and became more concrete to the people in the community, but then they had embraced Dr. King as the leader of that movement.
So when Reverend King was elected and he gave his acceptance speech that night at Whole Street Church, and one of the old ladies in the audience said, oh Lord, you have sent us a savior.
Through the creation of the Montgomery Improvement Association, which was organized to shepherd the boycott, the black leadership in Montgomery had to appeal to the entire black community. And one of the ways that that was done was through the mass meeting.
My first encounter with Dr. King was at the first mass meeting, and I heard him speak there. Of course, me being 12 years old, and in the audience, I really didn't interact with him, but I was very impressed with his words.
You also have, with the Montgomery Improvement Association and the mass meeting, a melding of the different classes in Montgomery, which is, I think, critical to the success of the Montgomery bus boycott. The ability to reach beyond class lines, which are stark in the black community, and to involve the totality of the black community in the process.
They were devising the people, which were the domestic people who really made the boycott. They wasn't the brain power. And the people who were riding the bus, see, educated black people did not ride the bus because they all had cars.
When ministers took a position, particularly when they came together and took a position, they brought with them they had a multiplying effect because they brought their congregations in many cases with them.
And Joanne Robinson and Mary Fair Blakes were the two ladies, and they had some affiliation with Dexter Church. So, but the president of the college told them, do what you got to do for civil rights, but do not get the college involved in it because we're all on the state payroll. And so this church had to kind of stay in the background, but they basically furnished the leadership, the brain power behind the leadership came from the church.
Joanne, who taught English and right across the hall from me, came to my office and said, Bryson, we have drawn up a memo that we're going to circulate all over the city. We are tired of this treatment that's going on, and we're going to say, stay off the bus for one day, just one day, and let them know that we are tired of this.
Working with our teacher, you know, we were secretly running off leaflets to people.
I was one of the youth who they gave the leaflets to pass out announcing the boycott over the weekend. And then we kind of kept people apprised of meetings.
I was a student riding in the segregated buses over there, going downtown and back and forth. So naturally, during the bus boycott, the students at Alabama State and all of us, you know, we did what they led us to do, and we would go to the meetings and follow through with their particular direction.
I think that everybody understood the economics of boycotting. If the people lost money, that they would come up with a better system themselves with the bus companies.
In our heart and mind, we wondering, were black people going to stay together? Was the boycott going to be successful? And the first little incident, when that man stood on the corner of Jackson and Hutchinson Street with a trench coat and a hat, I could see his picture just like I'm looking at you. And that bus came up, but we couldn't see did the man get on the bus or not. And so one of the customers said, oh, heck on the bus, heck on the bus. And so all of us stopped cutting hair and went to the window to see where that man would get on the bus. That's the first incident. And when that bus pulled off, that man was still standing. We thought Joe Lewis had knocked out Max Miller. And we started hollering, and some of the companies ran out in the street and said, it wet.
By creating a church-based movement that was committed to nonviolent protest, King had provided a message and a method for others who sought to knock down the walls of discrimination. In 1960, King moved back to Georgia, and Atlanta became the epicenter of the civil rights movement. People from all walks of life joined in the fight for equality, but one group emerged at the forefront, driven by the hope of brighter tomorrows. Young people stepped out of their classrooms onto the front lines of the movement. Grassroots organizers and organizations mobilized to face down segregation wherever it was found. Cities such as Greensboro, Anniston, Birmingham, and Selma soon became synonymous with the civil rights movement.
A lot of times people come and they think these movements within the campaigns within the civil rights movement happened in a vacuum, that they popped up. But there was a progression between 1955 and 1965. Things happened, one thing built on the other.
My grandfather said, well, you know, instead of sitting there complaining, you have to get involved. And the opportunity came about when I was as a freshman at Morehouse, and the student movement had started in North Carolina, then I got an opportunity to become involved in the sittings.
The four students from North Carolina A&T sat in at Woolsworth, and my being involved in my own way in civil rights, this whole thing was God sent for me. I had seen Dr. King earlier when all of the students, leaders, came to Atlanta at the behest of Ella Baker to formally organize.
Well, I think the first time I had our encounter was during the Montgomery movement and how successful it was and how articulate he was. I mean, you know, he was able to lay out a project and lay out his strategy and, you know, so the guy was a thinker and you knew that he was also a problem solver. And little did I know that he would, you know, after the success of the Montgomery movement, that he would move to Atlanta. First, I met him in person. Well, you know, we had rallies a lot, and you know, a lot of times we had mass meetings every week. We had mass meetings, and this involved all the different churches in the city. And this way, we got a chance to meet the different ministers, but also we got a chance to lay out to the various communities in Atlanta what we were doing and what we were about.
I never thought that we would not be successful with the Freedom Rides. You were taught that, it's ingrained in you, we shall overcome. We were fighting for justice. Our cause was just, and there was never any doubt that eventually we would be successful.
I have no animosity toward those that beat me. In fact, one of my wishes before I leave this earth is that if any of the people who attacked us is alive, I'd love to have a cup of coffee or a sandwich or whatever they want to do. I'll even have a cold one with them if that's, you know. But I just wanted to let them know that I was 5'6", 126 pounds. I was no threat to anyone. But I just want to know why. Why did the sight of me upset you to the point that you would like to kill me?
We've come to see that this method is not a weak method, for it's the strong man who can stand up amid opposition, who can stand up amid violence being inflicted upon him and not retaliate with violence.
My father worked two jobs. He taught school 5 days a week, and he worked at nights and on the weekends at the Birmingham Country Club waiting tables. And my mother taught school, but for all of the taxes that they paid, those taxes supported all of the public facilities in Birmingham. But here we were not able to use those public facilities in Birmingham. We could not use the public library. We could not go to Kittyland. George Wallace said we could not attend the University of Alabama. So what I understood really well was that we had all of the burdens associated with citizenship, but not the privileges.
My first time in jail was during the time when Dr. King was in jail, when he wrote the letter to the ministers in Birmingham. And the matron looked at me and she said, "What are you doing here?" And I said, "I want my freedom." And she thought that was so funny because she thought that I was white.
Dr. King, at that point, for me, was not an icon. I thought, you know, well of him as a Baptist preacher and a great leader, but not a worldwide icon. So I wasn't internalizing his every word. Yes, I was impressed listening to him, looking at him, hearing the responses of all of those around us. But I didn't just internalize, this is what Dr. King said. I internalized what James Bevel said, because I felt that that affected me personally.
My first time encountering Dr. King was at 16th Street, and he was preaching.
I became our church Sunday school secretary in the seventh grade, and I just happened to be there when Dr. King came with Reverend Abernathy and Shuttlesworth and Bevel.
They had told us when we practiced, don't give information out because parents was being fired from their jobs.
When he went on to say, your parents really can't do anything about this, but you can. I thought, I can? He said, you don't have anything to lose because you're getting a second-class education. And I agreed with him. And that was the moment I decided whatever I could do to make a difference here, I wanted to do it.
It came clear when I was at the church and Dr. King was speaking and he said, we feel that the segregation laws are unjust laws. And Reverend Shuttlesworth said, we aim to kill segregation or be killed by segregation.
We are gonna walk nonviolently and peacefully. Let the nation and the world know we are tired now. We've lived with slavery and segregation 345 years. We've waited a long time for freedom. We are trying to remind the nation of the urgency of the moment. Now is the time to make real the promises of democracy. Now is the time.
You have to remember one thing. Dr. King never went anywhere that he was not invited. He received a letter from the Dallas County Voters League and Reverend F.D. Reese, its chairman, in November of 1964 to come to Selma. We need you.
Well, I guess that my my signature kind of invited him because the fact that I felt that we had been somewhat traveling through the many different communities, and coming to Selma, I felt that Selma was a place that could really be seen as the turning point.
We had a sheriff named Jim Clark, and he would stand on the courthouse steps and wore a big button that said never. Every day when the marches went from Brown Chapel to the courthouse, he would be standing on those steps to turn them away. So they knew that they had a somewhat immovable object here too. In Jim Clark.
And so it was a great delight for him to say, I'll be there. And when he said that, all of us became very elated. They began to shout because they knew that his coming would bring about a change in the condition that existed here in Selma.
My best friend Rachel and I, we were playing out in front of the now historic Brown's Chapel Church.
And as we were playing on this particular day, there were these beautiful cars that had driven up in front of Brown's Chapel Church that obviously gravitated our attention as children. One of the men that had gotten out of the car, he was putting this black jacket on this particular man who had on a nice white starchy shirt, black tie, black slacks. And he looked at us and he said, "Do you know who this man is?" And we looked at them because we didn't know who any of them were. And he said that this is Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And just all of a sudden, I just started smiling because it only reflected when I was sitting in the church and they were talking about him. And Dr. King suddenly started asking us our names. He asked us, where did we live? Where did we go to school? How old? The normal questions that an adult would ask children. The same man that placed that black jacket on Dr. King, when we got to the rear of the door as we were talking to Dr. King, and Dr. King was talking to us, he said, "You little children can go on and play now because we're about to have our meeting." And Dr. King suddenly said to him, he said, "No." And he grabbed us by our hands and took us on into that church. And he sat there patiently and he started asking us more questions. He said, "Now, what do you little girls want?" And my best friend and I looked at each other, not knowing how to answer that question. He said, "Now, children, when I ask you what do you want, I want you to say freedom." And he said, "Now, what do you little girls want?" And we said freedom in our own little childish voice. He said, "Now, say it louder, children." He said, "Now, what do you little children want?" And we said freedom louder. And then he asked us our second question. He said, "Now, when do you little girls want it?" And we looked at each other, not knowing how to respond to that question. He said, "Now, when I ask you, little girls, when do you want it, I want you to say what?" And we said, "Now."
It is the effort of American Negroes to secure for themselves the full blessings of American life. Their cause must be our cause, too. Because it's not just Negroes, but really it's all of us who must overcome the crippling legacy of bigotry and injustice. And we shall overcome.
With the passage of the Civil Rights Act in 1964 and the Voting Rights Act in 1965, King and other leaders of the movement saw that they were able to address racial inequality through legislation. King now turned the spotlight on economic inequality. Those who thought King was breaking new ground may have forgotten that the historic 1963 March on Washington was a march for jobs and equality. One place where King saw the issues of race and economics come together was Memphis.
In the summer of 1959, he comes to Memphis on behalf of a group of African Americans who are running for city offices. They include Benjamin Hooks, Eddie Van Willis, and Russell Sugarman. And he comes and he realizes very clearly that Memphis is important to the overall movement.
We just recently completed a historical marker for the Lee sisters, the most arrested family in America, according to Jet magazine.
My activism started in the civil rights movement in 1960, when my sister, Ernestine, my oldest sister, was a part of the first sit-in here in Memphis, when students at Lemoyne College and Owen Junior College decided that they were going to challenge the laws in the public facilities here in Memphis.
There were seven sisters who led that movement, and working with them, you know, they were high school and college age, and they would get arrested, get freed, go home, change clothes, go back out again.
Well, I was 16 years old when I was arrested the first time. So I was in high school, and that meant I had to go to juvenile court after my arrest. But that still didn't keep me from going right back and participating again.
After the public library was libraries were integrated, then it was a domino effect in the city. Downtown eateries were integrated. The zoo was integrated. Public parks were integrated as a result of the stance that the Lemoyne and Owen Junior College students made.
I met him, Dr. King, in person after he spoke at a church here in Memphis. And then the second time was on the Meredith, Mississippi March.
In 1966, Memphis is also the beginning of the Meredith March, the March Against Fear. James Meredith starts his movement in Memphis, his walk, and then, of course, he's right outside of Memphis when he gets shot. And then all the civil rights leaders converge on Memphis to take up the march that he now can no longer participate in because he's wounded in the hospital. So Dr. King comes back to Memphis.
He was very encouraging, and he said it was so wonderful to see all of us and our family especially on that march. There were, I think, 10 of us in my family on the march to Jackson, Mississippi.
The city in 1967 votes to change its charter to establish the mayor-council form of government. There was the African-American community were very involved in the adoption of this new charter. As a result, three African-Americans were elected to the city council. And in addition to the three African-Americans who were elected, a man named Henry Loeb was elected mayor.
He had been commissioner of public works before he was elected mayor. Mayor Loeb came out of all of that where it was, we're not racist, but we are paternalist, and black people, you know your place. Black Memphians stay in your place. And unions for Loeb, Loeb was anti-union. You know, you work, if you got a problem, I got an open door policy, you come talk to me with hat in hand.
Pressure, lack of communication, and these men have not been to the mayor's office where this matter will be decided, or an illegal strike or work stoppage, which are unlawful in Tennessee, are simply not the ways to handle a problem.
Loeb saw himself as a fiscal conservative. He did not believe in spending the people's money for anything. And as Public Works Commissioner, he refused to upgrade equipment, particularly the trucks that are used to haul garbage from people's homes to city dumps. The wages at the Public Works Department were very low. He kept them low. He basically treated the workers there as disposable because they were at the very bottom rung of the city ladder, the city government ladder, not to mention the social ladder of Memphis. So in effect, Henry Loeb as Public Works Commissioner lays the foundation for the sanitation strike.
Mayor Loeb was in power. And it was about the sanitation workers, fair wages.
I think the economics was an effect of racism and segregation. So it's not so much the economics affecting racism as racism affecting economics.
Dr. King comes to Memphis in 1968 because a group of African-American sanitation workers had gone on strike. And on the surface, maybe that doesn't look to be terribly important in the larger movement that Dr. King is trying to build. But in reality, it is a microcosm for exactly what Dr. King is trying to address.
I think that because he rolled out that Poor People's campaign early 68, it was already in the workings late 67, that the sanitation strike was ideal for this new platform that he was rolling out. He understood that.
You are reminding not only Memphis, but you are reminding the nation that it is a crime for people to live in this rich nation and receive starvation wages.
The sanitation workers are the very definition of the working poor in 1968. These guys suffer from extremely low wages. The conditions are unsafe. In fact, in part, what precipitated the strike was the deaths of two African-American sanitation workers, Robert Walker Jr. and Ethel Cole, in February of 68.
If you look at the civil rights movement in Memphis, certain people will always be identified, the lawyers, the ministers, you know, the prominent citizens, and forgotten will be the ordinary people. Now, the sanitation strike changed all of that because people like Nickelberry and others have risen to the surface.
Yeah, I had to get a carriage because we weren't making no money. And so I signed up for a union because we weren't making no money. I figured if we signed up for a union, get a lot of people to back us up, we might could make a little more money and have better working conditions.
And they were only making 90 cents an hour. In addition to that, they were not allowed to change clothes after getting off work at 5 o'clock in the evening. They had to ride the bus with those garbage-smelling clothes on. They had to go into the yard and pick up your garbage in a tub and put that tub on their head and take it back to the truck and dump it in.
Because a lot of times, if a hole in my tub and I don't get there, it may get there in the morning, and I said, I need a new tub. Tell my boss, man, we ain't got no more new tub. So I had to use the same tub. They wouldn't give us no, every time a hole get in them tubs, they wouldn't give us no tub. I maybe had to have that tub for 2 or 3 days. And then finally, they had some old new tubs, and they'd give me a new tub. But most time, I had an old tub. I had to keep my job, so I just tilted on my head, put me a wide hat on my head, and just tilted on my job. And stuff to come on down. And I couldn't ride the bus. I get on the bus, people say, you old garbage man, you stink. So I started walking home.
As a free American citizen, you are expressing yourself by saying, I am not working for those stinking wages and conditions.
That's where the slogan came from, I am a man. They wanted to be treated equally.
We were doing a meeting at a church at the Union Hall, and they said, Dr. Martin Luther King coming to Memphis. So we all of us jumped up and started hollering, ooh, Dr. Martin needs to come. He coming to town and kick him down. And so he did come. You know, you heard about him that he did so many things, did a lot of march from different places, Montgomery and all that stuff there. So I heard about him. I said, if he can do all that, he can come to Memphis. He might do us some good.
When you bring in someone who has national exposure, that will elevate the power of the movement, that will also speak volumes to a mayor who is intractable, because now you're national news. It's not just about Memphis, Tennessee. You can't keep this quiet any longer. This is gonna be propelled into the national limelight. And if you have the pressure of the national media all focused on Memphis, they thought that it would certainly help to expedite a solution to the problem.
He had gained a great deal of recognition across the nation and other cities that he had worked with. And seeing his work from 1963 in Grand March on Washington, and seeing his great work in Montgomery, Alabama, we felt that his presence here would make a difference. And the way that he fought was one that we really appreciated, and his philosophy was one that we adhered to, and that is passive resistance and nonviolence.
Delighted I am to be in Memphis tonight and to see you here in such large and enthusiastic numbers. As I came in tonight, I turned around and said to Ralph Abernathy,
they really have a great movement here in Memphis.
There was tension, and there was going to be some kind of explosion of some form. So if you consider the civil rights movement an explosion, a nonviolent explosion, then and there may be in some ways we should thank God for Dr. King in that explosion could have taken on a much more violent tone. You had many in the country, even during the time of Dr. King, had the Black Panthers and others who wanted to fight.
Even though you are leading a peaceful movement, there are always detractors who are not a part of the movement who tend to create the problem because they believe in chaos and they believe in disruption.
The last march of his life was March 28, 1968. The white rednecks didn't want Dr. King in town stirring things up, and the black radicals didn't think he was moving fast enough, the Panthers and the invaders. So they knew there was going to be trouble the next day.
It was just like a war zone. It's just like a war zone. People running from different places, they had to fight the weight of the police because police were hooping heads.
Let me tell you the lowest moment. That was when I came out of the basement of Claiborne Temple, where we all went for meetings and strategy and everything. I always took my children to the meetings because I wanted to inculcate determination in them. I had one child in a stroller, a toddler, and I had one 3 or 4 years old. And I came out of the basement of Claiborne Temple, and we were maced by the police, my two little children and me.
It was one of the biggest frustrating moments of Dr. King's life, I think, because he was such a guy who believed in peaceful protest. And so he was extremely disheartened. It rattled him to his core.
As I walked, I was agonizing over what had developed. And I told Reverend Lawson, who had the bullhorn, to call it off and turn the people back, which he did.
That was the violence that broke out in 1968. March 28th. That was the last march that I had with King.
50 years after King's assassination, those who participated in the civil rights movement can help us to understand how in the span of 14 years, a nonviolent movement armed only with prayer and peaceful protest could face down armed resistance and dismantle more than 300 years of institutional inequality. With understanding comes appreciation.
His speaking ability, his intellect, and he could move you. You know, I mean, he was a minister, that is true, but he preached that social gospel that you would follow that man into hell.
If you were born into this segregated system, you automatic was in uniform. Your uniform was your black race. So when another general come in, like we said, King, it's easy for you to follow.
His presence just moved you. I mean, you know, there was a spirit about him, something that you knew that you believed in him.
He was a great leader because he could get a lot of people together. You know, he had a march on Washington. And when you get a lot of people like that, that's a bad man. He's a bad man. We didn't get them many people there.
One thing about him, and perhaps to his own detriment, he was not afraid.
The courage that Dr. King exhibited
gave courage to others to step out and take a stand or to take a chance on getting it right.
You can tell a natural leader because he's going to speak the truth to you whether you want to hear it or not.
Looking back on it, I think he was a genius with people in terms of bringing people together, because he had to pull together disparate elements of the Black community, let alone addressing the issues that the Black community was facing in the broader society.
A person with so much gravity like Dr. King had, you understood what it meant to love somebody.
People talk about Dr. King now, and if you listen to him, you would think that Dr. King wanted to be on the top of notoriety, but he did not. He was just Dr. King.
I remember one march we were having, and we were marching down the road, and we marched by this pool hall on Auburn Avenue. And Dr. King just marched right into the pool hall and confronted the guys there who were shooting pool. And he convinced several of them to come and join the march.
His ability to actually get people to understand what he was trying to get them to see, the kind of language he used.
He was very much in tune with the events of this country, and he had a way of taking two documents, the Bible and the founding documents of this nation, and he would put the two together. And you, if you remember in many of his speeches, he says, all we're asking is for you to be true to what you said on paper.
We saw him as a man led by God to do work that would be for the salvation of his people.
He was very mesmerizing. That's the only way I can explain it. And he started off very calmly, and his voice kind of reached a crescendo, and he became very passionate, and he just reminded me of an old Southern Baptist clergyman. You know, the resonances in his voice.
It's like running home to see the Lone Ranger. Superman. That's how he was to me. He had me in awe. His voice, when he spoke, you got quiet and you made everybody else get quiet and you listened. The reading words, when you read them, then sound is good. It's when you heard his clips and his videos. It was just amazing.
Dr. King's leadership was one of that was quite unusual. He understood the conditions that we lived under. He understood that we were going to have challenges. And so he encouraged us to stay the course, that the laws would change, that we had to be the change if anything was going to be different here in this country.
You had already had the 64 public accommodation. You go to any restaurant, any park, you could vote in the 1965 Voting Rights Act. So all those things was accomplished under his somewhat leadership. And so then what we felt that we was on the way.
Even though the restaurants, the hotels, et cetera, are desegregated, if people don't have the jobs that afford them the resources to take advantage of those opportunities, they can't.
We still are experiencing much of the same. As a matter of fact, I think we have regressed in certain areas.
Look at the Memphis Grizzlies. You got millionaires there. You know, what's left? Everything. What more can you do? And that's not the case, though, because right in the shadows of the FedEx Forum, you got people in abject poverty who are black and so sleeping on the street. So there's a lot that has not been overcome, even though in some sense there's an appearance that much has been overcome.
One of the main goals of the Civil Rights Movement was to remove all of these laws that limited blacks' access to the middle class. Those laws have been virtually removed, which means education. You can go to any university that you want to. The fair employment laws meant these job opportunities are now open. Voting rights, even though there are still areas where they are trying to roll those back. So the answer is a resounding yes. We have overcome. Is there still racism here? Yes.
There's still injustice in every element. The same thing that Dr. King was fighting for, and he spoke very vividly about economic injustice, especially in his last speech. So we still have those same obstacles today.
You think you're in Memphis, Tennessee, and you ain't your boy? A lot of people call you boy. Hey, boy, you're still a boy.
Things have been covered up, and things have changed, like you say, to a certain extent. And I wonder, if I was a child, and I'm in my early 70s now, how things are gonna be in 10 years.
And when you see blacks and whites together, even to this day, you get a second look.
They're fighting it still today to erase his legacy. And it's being shown in these crowds and these Nazi signs and these feelings of hatred coming out. We have to overcome, we have to help our people to overcome those prejudices, those feelings. And that can't be regulated. We have to have some moral authority. Dr. King had moral authority.
I don't know how we're going to handle this one, because we've got to get leaders together, or a leader who would take a stand and say, this is the way it's going to be. We've got to have another Martin Luther King.
We still haven't overcome. We've made some changes. Legislation has been passed, and that's good, but you can't legislate love. And so we still have a ways to go to make people treat people respectfully and on a level playing field.
We need to learn to dialogue. We can't talk, most people are afraid to talk about race because they can't talk about it without confrontation.
Land of the free, home of the brave. If we really want to live up to the name that America has given itself, you know, most people see it as an experiment right now. It has not accomplished everything it said it was going to be about. I think Langston Hughes says, America never was America to me. But I swear by God, it will be. So if we want to arrive there, it's going to take all of us. And we can't ask that question of any one group.
When I hear the word, we shall overcome, it refers to me as this country and this world. We all are in this together.
We have a long way to go as far as the African American is concerned in this country. And we're continuing, and we're going to continue, and we're going to remember Martin and Coretta and those persons that gave the, as Abraham Lincoln said, what, the last full measure of devotion.
You can kill the king, but if that dream is in another man's heart, then he's still alive. And so being able to know what he stood for and how what he stood for became a part of the life of so many people, then you can understand how he still lives, although he might not be physically alive, but he's living in the hearts and lives of so many people. And so we thank God for that.
Most stories have a beginning, a middle, and an end. What is unique about the story and the life of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. is that the end is also a beginning. Many who took part in the Civil Rights Movement used it as a blueprint for their lives and careers. Their experiences provide insight into one of the defining eras in the history of the United States. They saw the obstacles that were overcome, they see problems still to be overcome, and they tell us what it means to live a life with infinite hope. This program was made possible in part by the Roy H. Park School of Communications at Ithaca College and by Roger Rada.